One fine day with a wolf and a purr, babies were born that caused a little stir. No blue buzzer, no three-eyed frog, it was a canine feline little cat dog. Cat dog, cat dog. Alone in the world with a little cat dog. When big old Jack, he came to town, all a bunch of gifters putting cat dog down. Ripped off a leg, tore off an arm, you know it's Kaido that caused that harm. Cat dog, cat dog. Alone in the world with a little cat dog. Yeah! Nailed it! All right, now I hope you have that song stuck in your head for at least the rest of the day, because in order to prepare for that intro, I have probably listened to the cat dog theme song no less than 36 times within the last 4 hours, okay? So that's not gonna, it's gonna be a while to get that out of here, okay? But that's the only way I could really think to start it off. Hey everybody, how you doing? Tekking101 here, and today's video is going to be about the masters of Zo, Lord Inuarashi and Nekomamushi, who are in conjunction the rulers of Zo, Inuarashi being the Duke of the Day, Nekomamushi being the ruler of the night. And at exactly 6 p.m. every single day on Zo, they make a shift, and then Nekomamushi takes over, and then at 6 a.m. the following morning, the shift happens again, and then Inuarashi rules over the country. So, they both have a very interesting history with each other. Going along with the logic that dogs and cats hate each other, which, by the way, this is mostly a dog house, which is why we don't have any figurines of cats or anything. I've just had dogs my whole life. But, most of the times I see dogs and cats, like my friends that have dogs and cats together, they don't typically hate each other. They might annoy each other every now and then. They're like roommates, you know? It's just like, hey, listen, just don't bug me every now and then. But I've never seen, like, a dog and a cat, like, at each other's throats. Maybe you have. You probably have. But that's the general idea we're going with here. So when we first meet them, they hate each other. That's why they've separated their kingdom, essentially, into two halves. Not literal halves, but, well, kind of. There's like the whale forest, which is where Nekomamushi's forest guardians reside, and then there's the town, Claw City, I believe it was called, where Inuarashi and his musketeers mostly reside. But mostly it's just a time split, because, you know, Zo is a pretty large country. You know, it's on the back of Zunisha, which, as we now know, is like 20 miles, you know, long by like 35,000 meters tall. So pretty big country there you have to work with. But just to make everything simple, they just divided it in terms of, all right, Nekomamushi, you rule for 12 hours, and then we switch out, and then Inuarashi rules for 12 hours. That's just how it works. Although, ever since the Straw Hats and the Kozukis showed up to the island to get Raizo back, it looks like they're going to be working together. And in fact, I would love to see a fight scene in Wano where we see them both team up and take out an all-star. I think they could take out an all-star, totally. Have it be Jack. Actually, you know what? That would probably work the best, because Jack was the one that showed up and stomp the crap out of their country and almost wipe them out with Caesar's gas weapons. So I could see that going down. I mean, we've seen Jack brawl with Ashura Doji a little bit, but if all of the 9 Red Scabbards are going to get like a big major fight in this arc, have Inu and Neko team up and beat the ever-loving crap out of Jack. That would be the perfect end to his character. Like, no, they're not just gonna beat him down. They're gonna end him. All right, after all that stuff that happened. Especially since it was because of Jack why they lost an arm and a leg, respectively. Nekomamushi got his arm removed, and Inuarashi lost a leg in the process of the torture that they were going through, right? So, it would actually be really poetic if they finish off Jack with, like, a combo attack to compensate for each other's lost limb. You know, like, Inuarashi uses a punch to compensate for Nekomamushi's lost arm, and Nekomamushi uses his leg to compensate for Inuarashi, and that's, like a combo attack. Like, you're, like, I'm not exactly, like, painting a great picture here, but you can kind of get the idea. Like, a double-page spread, end of the chapter, Jack is in the background just getting slammed by Nekomamushi and Inuarashi in the foreground. They just slam their attacks into him, like, charge up their electro, and just BAM! And then Jesus gets, you know, just electrocuted and just dropped, and that's the end of the chapter, alright? You're getting that mental image. I want that to happen, okay. So, in the latest Vivara card, though, Vivara card number 11, I actually didn't bring up any anything involving them. Most of the stuff we know, we already found out about. Like, they were on Whitebeard's crew at some point. They were also on Roger's crew at some point. They washed ashore at Wano at some point. None of these time frames were really given in the Vivera card, although we did get their ages. They are the same age, which means, like, yeah, they were probably most likely born around the same time. Maybe to the same parents, because genetics on Zoe with the Minx work the same way as, like, with the Fishmen and the Merfolk, as I mentioned in that Vivera card video yesterday. So, you know, they might have the same parents for all we know. That might make their, like, sibling rivalry and their cat and dog rivalry just make more sense. Like, oh, they're brothers. That's why they're kind of at each other's throats every now and then. Okay, that works. Maybe not. But they're both 40 years old. Okay, so this actually gives us some information on how much time they had to really travel the world, okay? Because Roger, we know they traveled on Roger's ship for a little while. They didn't go on the final journey to Raftel, though, all right? However, we know Roger was executed 24 years ago, which means at the time of Roger's execution, Neko and Inu were both 16 years old. All right, so they're still, like, by our standards, they're, like, you know, sophomores in high school when that happened. Now, the final journey that Roger took started a year before his execution. So 25 years ago, that's when Roger got the Orojax and got the crew together for one last hurrah, the swan song of the Roger crew, and they sailed out and they eventually made it to Raftel. Now, it's possible that Inu and Neko might have joined them very briefly on that journey. You know, they might have only traveled with them for the same time like Vivi traveled with the Straw Hats. You know, just, you know, a few story arcs, but nothing like substantial, right? I think that makes the most sense, because we know that Inu and Neko, they washed ashore at Wano when they were little kids. We don't know how old they are. I'm assuming they're both 8, though, because whenever we talk about little kids in One Piece, they're always 8 years old. You ever notice that? You know, Tama is 8, I believe, Momo is 8, I think Otoko is 8. They're all around 8 years old. It's strange. That's like a default that Oda has for little kid characters, okay? So maybe they washed ashore, maybe they were a little younger, okay? But they were born on Zoe. Something happened, I'm not sure what, they fell over the side of the elephant and they drifted ashore to Wano, okay? Also, possibly Kawamatsu might have been there as well, because in that flashback where we see Nekomamushi and INUARASHI, you know, on the shores of Wano as little kids, we also barely just see another character, possibly a Mink, next to them. All right, so that might have been how that went there, okay? But they washed ashore at Wano when they were little kids. They eventually, you know, they had their childhood on Wano, essentially, grew up and became vassals and retainers of Odin. And that would eventually lead them to becoming members of the Nine Red Scabbards. So I like to think they spent a decent amount of their, you know, formative years on Wano, all right? We see the Nine Red Scabbards when they were younger in that one flashback. Inu and Neko, they might have only been, like, keep in mind they're minks, so even when they're little kids, they have the ability to use Electro, and they can definitely fight. Oda made a point to show that during when Jack invaded. Even the little kids were able to deal some damage to the Pleasures and the Gifters and stuff, all right? Jack, of course, was a whole other league, but even little kid minks can still fight on their own. So Inu and Neko could have been, like, 10 years old during that flashback, but they still probably would have been pretty decent fighters, especially if they were raised in Wano, a country full of, like, samurai and strong warriors. So, you know, age isn't that big of a deal there. But at some point, they left Wano to go journey with Whitebeard first, and then they joined Roger at some point. We don't know how long they spent on Whitebeard's crew, we don't know how long they spent on Roger's crew, and we don't know what circumstances led to them leaving Wano to join Whitebeard, and then leaving Whitebeard briefly to go to Roger, and then what happened after that? Did they travel with Roger just a little bit, and then did they go back to Whitebeard, or did they just go back to Zoe? Because as it stands right now, they're the leaders of their country, so I imagine they've had to be the leaders for at least a decade or so to cement themselves as, like, you know, we are the rulers of this land, all right? So, maybe it's possible what this happened. Maybe they washed ashore at Wano, spent a few years there, learned to fight, you know, Odin trusted them, made them members of the Scabbards, and they really respected Odin. But at the end of the day, they wanted to go back home. You know, they wanted to journey. They wanted to get back to Zunisha. But Zunisha is kind of a phantasmal island. It's an elephant. And if they didn't have any Vivra cards or an Eternal... Well, I guess an Eternal Pose wouldn't work. They would have had to use a Vivra card or have some other method of finding Zoe. They were just kind of stuck on Wano. Well... maybe Whitebeard then showed up, and maybe Izo could tie back into that at some point, because Izo is also from Wano. We don't know how old Izo is. During Marineford, he looked rather young. He looked like in his 20s, but he's also, like, he's a kabuki actor, so he likes to cross-dress and wear makeup and things, so he might be a lot older. He might be in his 50s or 60s, as much as we know. I mean, this is One Piece, and he just wears the makeup and dyes his hair, okay? But, you know, so they might have, you know, had something to do with Izo there, and Whitebeard, you know, recruited Izo, and then was sailing out from Wano, and he asked, you know, hey, if you guys want to join us, we can take you back to our island, to your island, to Zoe. And so they went with Whitebeard, and then maybe, I'm trying to think here, because Whitebeard and Roger, they didn't hate each other, but, you know, they were kind of rivals. You know what I mean? Like, every now and then they'd have a cup of sake and everything and go along, but it wasn't like they were always buddy-buddy on the ocean, you know? They even Whitebeard said, you know, me and Roger locked horns a bunch of times back in the day. So, I mean, it's possible that Roger and Whitebeard could have met up at some point, and they maybe Roger came out with his sword, and Whitebeard came out with his Bicento, and Roger's like, ah, Whitebeard, how you doing, you old coot? And they have, like, kind of that scene when Whitebeard clashed with Shanks. They just, like, took out their weapons, and then boom, and then just, like, a big epic clash, and, like, the skies are rent asunder. Maybe it was something like that, like, Roger and Whitebeard came out, and they clashed, and then they're just like, ah, you old bastard, come here! And then they were chilling out, and they were having some sake or whatever, and, you know, maybe Roger brought up, you know, like, oh, who are those, who's the cat and the dog you got over there, Whitebeard? What's going on? Your crew's so weird. And then, you know, maybe they found out, like, oh, well, Roger's heading in the direction of Zoe, or maybe Roger had some means to find Zoe, or he had some business on Zoe. And at that point, he was like, oh, well, come on, boys, come on to my crew, and I'll take you back home. But here's the thing, though. Even after traveling with Whitebeard and Roger, it's not like Roger or Whitebeard took them back to Zoe and they went up the elephant and they stayed there until present. No, because they were also there during, they were in Wano during the execution of Odin when Kaido and Orochi took over the place 20 years ago when they were both 20 years old. You know, they were present, and that's actually when they started bickering with each other, when during Odin's execution they were rushing back to Odin Castle to make sure everyone was okay, like Lady Toki and Hiyori and Momo. That's when they started arguing, and that's when that started, okay? Which means, okay, so, started off on Zoe, they were born there, fell off the elephant or something, maybe with Kawamatsu, landed in the ocean, drifted to Wano, got to Wano, befriended Onin, became the Scabbards, traveled with Whitebeard for a little bit, traveled with Roger for a little bit, maybe went back to Whitebeard, but this was when they were in their teenage years. You know, they couldn't have traveled with Roger after he was dead. So, you know, Roger was executed 24 years ago, so they were only, like, you know, 15 probably when they were traveling with him about 25 years ago, at the latest, 15. But then after traveling with Roger, they either, you know, Roger either dropped them off in Wano, or they went back to Whitebeard and ended up back in Wano somehow. And then they stayed as Scabbards, and then Odin was executed, and then they witnessed that at 20 years ago. And then after that, I'm not really sure what happened. Somehow, through some means, they both ended up leaving Wano and getting back to Zoe. They probably, I would assume, bailed out. Maybe not, like, after, like, they still wanted to be loyal to the Kozuki clan, that they were the Nine Red Scabbards, they were part of that. But maybe after Lady Toki explained the plan to everybody, you know, explained to them, like, what she's going to do with the time fruit and sending everybody in the future and kind of like, you know, this country right now, you can't win, it's impossible, okay? So maybe at that point it's like, alright, Kinemon, Kanjuro, Raizo, Kiku, Momo got sent to the future. Kawamatsu tries to save Hiyori. Lady Toki dies. And as for Nekomamushi and INUARASHI, they decided just to flee Wano, get on a boat as soon as Kaido and Orochi were taken over while the country was still burning. They left the country arguing with each other, like, it's your fault this happened, you dumb cat! Oh, you stupid dog! I hate you! And they managed to get back to Zou, and, you know, they started up, you know, ruling over the country eventually. This was 20 years ago. They probably didn't stay on Wano very much longer after the takeover occurred. You know, Ashura Doji and Kawamatsu and Denjiro, they all stayed on the island on Wano. But, yeah, Inu and Neko probably bailed, you know. Not because they wanted to, but because, you know, they had to get back to Zou to maybe rally some, you know, support. So they maybe have to, someday, if they wanted to liberate Wano, they have to wait for that day. A big theme of the Minks is waiting for the dawn of the new era. So then maybe that they equated it with that a little bit, you know, just like, oh, we've been waiting for the dawn of this new era for a while now. We also have to wait 20 years until the Kozuki clan returns. And when they do, we can help them. It's just that their relationship became strained with each other after, you know, this one problem there. Because Odin was somebody they both looked up to. And then he died, and we don't know the whole circumstances around Odin's death. We know he was most likely boiled alive, which is horrible. You know, the way that Orochi was like, oh, you want some nice boiled Odin then, do ya? You know? So maybe Inu and Neko were there, but they couldn't do anything to stop it, and they just blamed each other for it. But after, like I said, after the Kozukis arrived at Zou with the Straw Hats, and like, Raizo is safe, and it's just such a beautiful scene there, they start working together now. Because it's like they have the interest back. He's like, Odin is gone, and he's never coming back, but we can carry on his legacy. The time is now. We waited 20 years. It was hell. You know, people of Wano have went through crap, but you know what? We can do this now. We can make this right, but we gotta work together. And so Nekomamushi is currently not on Wano. He's heading toward Wano. He went to go visit Marco. INUARASHI is located on Wano, along with Momo and everybody, and Wanda and Carrot, everybody are there. So they're going to meet up at some point, and I'm hoping they don't argue. Maybe they might bicker a little bit, kind of like Sanji and Zoro kind of deal, but they'll know what they have to do. They'll know that the main objective here is to, you know, honor Odin's legacy and get rid of Kaido and get rid of Orochi and bring the country back to its rightful ruler, who is Momo, the ruler, so the heir of Odin. So I think they got this. Now, something else that was revealed, probably the most interesting thing that was revealed in the latest Vivara card, was Haki. So it was revealed that INUARASHI has armament and observation. Makes sense. He's a pretty strong fighter. I'm really surprised a lot of people because, you know, Jack shows up to Zou, and we as a fan base don't know anything about the Minks at this point. Zou is this, you know, really cool island on top of an elephant and everything, and it's a really neat looking place, but we don't know anything about the Minks. We haven't really seen any yet. We saw Beppo, but, you know, we didn't really see Beppo show off Electro or anything like that at Sabaody or whatever. But anyway, Jack shows up, and he has all these beast pirates with him. He's got Sheep's Shed, he's got Gene Rummy, who, by the way, are both kind of dead. Yeah, they fell into the ocean. It's pretty much been confirmed. Yeah, they're dead, and they have artificial zones, but they're weak to that, so, yeah, and I don't think they're gonna survive. I don't think they're full fishmen like Jack was. But you have this introduction of Jack, giant mammoth dude, 1 billion berry bounty, and he goes to swipe at INUARASHI, just this regular, I mean, he's a little taller than a regular human. I think he's like 8 or 9 feet tall, but not anything on Jack. Swings his giant trunk, and INUARASHI just, bam, blocks the trunk like that. And it's like, then proceeds to pull out his rapier and then charge it up with Electro, and it's like, all right, it's on. And even more of an epic moment, what I like even more, was when Nekomamushi makes his first appearance. That is one of my favorite scenes in all of One Piece, period. All right, it's the build-up to that was great, where they were fighting all day, and then it's like twilight, and the clock in Zou, it strikes 6 o'clock, and you just hear that, Gyor-Niao! Coming from the forest. And everybody just kind of stops what they're doing, and I love what INUARASHI says. You know, the other musketeers are like, you know, like, oh, what are we gonna do, sir? You know, he's awake. And INUARASHI, he like sheaves his sword, and he's like, all right, fall back, men. And they're like, well, aren't we going to fight with them? You know, because normally they're, you know, at odds with each other. You know, they normally like, okay, the day is mine, the night is yours, cat. But this is a special circumstance because they're being invaded by a Yonko commander, okay? So they're like, aren't we going to fight together with them? But INUARASHI was really smart. He's like, no, no, we'll keep to the ships like we've always done, you know, because that way we can go rest for 12 hours while, you know, the Forest Guardians come out and fight fresh. But, you know, Kaido's crew, you know, Jack and the Gifters and Gene Rummy and everybody, they're not going to be able to get a time to rest. So that was really smart fighting in shifts, okay? And so you just have this moment where Jack's looking down at him and Inarashi's like, you know, Jack, just letting you know, buddy, you are not the only idiot out there in the world. I mean, you're an idiot, but there are idiots no matter where you go. And then, like, just this... The smoke from the battlefield just, you know, obfuscates them. That's a word you don't get to use often. Obfuscate. Just obfuscates them a little bit, and then they all disappear to hide to replenish their, you know, energy and heal a little bit. And then all of a sudden, this monster cat just comes rushing out of the freaking forest, you know, claws protruding, grabs Jack's trunk and just suplexes him over the freaking, just slams him into the ground. And Nekomamushi appears. He's got this awesome, like, crescent scar on his face, jagged teeth. You know, he's just like, it's my country when the moon comes out. And, you know, that was a beautiful scene. But here's the thing from the Vivara card we found out regarding Haki. Nekomamushi don't have any. Yeah, according to the Vivara card, INUARASHI has armament and observation. Neko has none. Now, I started to think, like, why would that be the case? You know, you might be thinking, well, you know, he's a cat. Cats are always kind of very highly attuned to their senses and everything like that, so maybe he doesn't need observation Haki because his natural senses are always so high. You know, because if you ever seen a clumsy cat, no, they don't exist out there. I have seen quite a few of clumsy dogs, though. A few times, actually. Duchess, who's not home right now. My mom took Duchess to visit her boyfriends for the time being. But, Duchess, she'll come up on my bed and I'll give her like a tummy rub and then she'll be like, oh, that feels good. And then she'll just like accidentally like fall off the side of my bed. And I'm like, oh, are you okay? You know, like a few clumsy moments with her. But cats, they're 100% dexterous all the time, right? So maybe that might be a reason. You know, armament, like, I'll tell you what, even though Neko might not have it, seems like he does perfectly fine. Now, granted, Jack did not have Haki either, so it was a moot point there. It didn't really matter. Neko didn't have it, Jack also didn't have it, so it just relied pretty much on just brute strength and your senses, and of course, you know, Nekomamushi's a cat, so he has, like, claws, and he can grab people and dig them in there and, you know, flip them around and stuff, and he's really agile, he can jump super high in the air, you know, land on his feet. He really likes eating lasagna, which I love I just love those little jokes that Oda throws out, like, he's a cat, and he loves lasagna, and I'm like, oh no, was that a damn freaking Garfield reference? Okay, fine, whatever, you get away with it. The scenes where Robin's holding up the little cat toy and Nekomamushi's batting at it, like, oh, that's nice. You know, INUARASHI likes to eat bones, you know, because he's a dog. I'm like, okay, it's funny, I get it. But yeah, it is a little weird, especially since both of them probably had the same kind of training. If they were trained in battle on Wano most of their lives under Odin, you know, learning Haki probably there. That's probably where INUARASHI learned it, was on Wano. And yet Neko didn't. Maybe he just didn't have an aptitude for it. Or maybe Odin told him, like, you don't need Haki because of your natural abilities or anything like that. I'm not really sure what the circumstance is there. It is pretty odd. It's so odd, in fact, I expect that to be probably touched upon in the story. To be brought up at some point. You know, maybe Nekomamushi's going up against a character that's really good at using Haki. Maybe Queen or King are really good at using Haki. And Neko's like, oh man, this isn't good. Or I mean, we haven't really seen any Logias yet in Wano. It's mostly been zones, like ancient zones and mythical zones and stuff. But, you know, if Neko ever ran into a Logia user, that would probably be a moment where he would say to himself, like, ooh, this isn't good. I can't find a bad matchup for that because I don't have armament. It definitely should be referenced, because if they were trained under the same person, why don't they both have Haki, or at least an understanding of Haki? And this was before they started fighting. You might throw that out there, like, oh, well, maybe they were, you know, they're at each other's throats and stuff, so they're like, he's like, I don't need, oh, the stupid dog learned Haki? I don't need to learn Haki in order to fight. No, they didn't start bickering until they were both 20 years old. So their foremost training, what they probably learned haki was probably before that, I would assume so. But aside from Neko's lack of haki, I mean, they both have Electro, which, I mean, that's their go-to being Minx. That's the thing they've trained in for probably even longer than Inurashi has trained in haki. They have Electro. So there's that. We still need to see both of their Sulong forms, which I guarantee you we're gonna get that in the land of, Wano arc. That's kind of pretty much a foregone conclusion. Man, I kind of want to see, I've mentioned it before, but I want to see, like, all the Minx, like, let's say Jack, not just Jack, but Jack has, like, a bunch of headliners and a bunch of gifters. Like, he amassed, like, the Jack army, and that's, like, one branch of the attack, and Jack is going after them, and then they just look up on, like, a mountain, and it's in the middle of the night in Wano, and you just see that moon in the background, the full moon, and you don't see them, you just see, like, the silhouettes of all the Minx, the Musketeers, the Forest Guardians, Neko, Inu, Wanda, Carrot, all in Sulong form at the top of the mountain, just their red eyes just staring down at Jack, at all the gifters, everybody there, like maybe an army of like over 100 smile users, and they're just staring down, and Jack looks up and he's just like, oh shit, and they just all jump off the mountain and just charge on him, and they just rip him to shreds, you know, after all the crap that they did on Zoe. And then Inu and Neko in their Sulong forms, they jump on Jack and they just beat the ever-loving crap out of him. That's what I want to see. But yeah, it's pretty intense. It's gonna get crazy coming up here, so I can't wait for the Minx when they go into action. I can't wait for Neko to arrive on the island. It's gonna be a good time. But yeah, I just wanted to address that quick video on Inu and Neko. I think it was warranted. Thanks for watching, everybody. Leave a comment below on what you think about Nekomamushi's lack of haki, what their Sulong transformations are going to look like. Keep in mind, even when they go into Sulong, I don't think their Sulongs are not like Resurrections for like Bleach characters where they heal their wounds. So don't expect like Inurashi to go into his Sulong and like regrow a leg. You know, I don't think that's how it's gonna work. But still, even, I mean, like, that's the thing though. Even with only one leg, and even with Neko's one arm, they can still fight. You know, I mentioned Inu uses a rapier, Neko uses like this kind of like staff thing, kind of like, I don't know what it's called. It's like a polearm weapon with like, it's like a trident at each end though. He can kind of twirl around. I don't know what it's called, but it looks really cool. So he uses that as a main weapon. So I'm sure he could still do that with one hand. Inu could fight still. He has both hands, obviously. Might be a little bit, you know, hindered by his lack of a leg, but he could still fight. So I can't wait for that moment. The Sulong versus Jack fight that I'm sure is gonna happen. But anyway, thanks for watching, everybody. This will be Tekken signing out. Cat dog. Cat dog. Alone in the world with a little cat dog. Okay. I might be violating Nux's territory here, but you know, looking at the cat dog cartoon so much, I'm just like, you know, the deep understanding philosophy of cat dog. No, I just want to really mention, because cat dog was one of those cartoons I watched a lot when I was a kid, but I hadn't really watched much since then. Like Scooby-Doo, like I'll watch Scooby-Doo anytime. I'm watching it right now, actually. You know, like I'll watch Scooby-Doo whenever, but cat dog was one of those things like, okay, I watched when I was a kid, didn't really watch much when I grew up. But going back and watching a few episodes, I'm really looking at it like, you know what cat dog's message is? It's, you know, it's okay to be different. Because that's the whole thing. Cat dog is like this person, dog, cat that's, you know, different from everybody else, and they kind of live by themselves and everything, but they're perfectly normal, really. I mean, like, that's kind of the message of the show. And so I like that. I like that little message of things, you know, just like, you know, if you're a little bit different than everyone else, it doesn't mean you're a freak. It doesn't mean you're this aberrant thing. It's just like, you know, you're just a little different. It's fine. So I'm sure that resonated a lot with kids growing up. So that's a cool thing. So yeah, that's the deep philosophy of cat dog. All right. See you, everybody. Signing out.